Nanking, the capital of Jiangsu province. A historical city that is full of vitality. A merge of the classics and modernity. It embodies a long story, no matter it is glorious or devastated. It reflects 100 years of history, the serendipity of a growing land, the perfect combination of the East and the West. From the ancient capital to the modern city, we are here to develop the origin of the modern China spirit. Time flies. Flies like an arrow. The scar in the diaries of John Rain has already become part of history. On behalf of our cultural memory, we began to write new stories for this land. This would be an epic for us.
another complex city, the past capital of China, with a lot of memories and a lot of historical parts. Maybe the city in China was looking more for quality of life, starting from the tradition, because this is the soul of Nanjing, not like the other Chinese city going towards the future without looking at the past, but always looking at the past. And the question is how in a society, how in a country like China, that is even today maybe a collectivist country, it's a communist country, even if it's also a capitalistic country, you can use money, which kind of money, where did you find money to improve the quality of a city like Nanjing? This is a question, another question. And I asked this to Professor Bao Li. She's the director of the Department of Architecture in the School of Architecture of Southeast University, Dongnan Tashui in Nanjing. And I'm very happy that also she, together with Frank, is here to tell us something about this part, this other part of the city.
Firstly, I should say many thanks to Professor Marco to invite me to be here with you and share some of my research and discovery, and also show my city. But actually, the video Marco just showed you is so shining, beyond I know, actually. I'm not nightlife animal, so I don't know there are so shining in the evening, in the night. But I'm proud of my city. And also, I would like to share with you about the city's history and nowadays. I was asked to give a lecture, maybe not a lecture, just some words to share with you about the decision making for the urban regeneration. I think in my understanding, regeneration means a process. Firstly, it should have generation, then we will have the chance and have the requirement to be regeneration. So I would like to start with the city history, shaping a Chinese city as Nanjing. Some brief introduction, even though you already know a little bit, a lot of images of Nanjing. But Nanjing is the location of Nanjing is actually it's a quite important place. It's almost in the mid part of the south and the north, and also it is a mega city in the eastern coastal region of China. More than 6 million people lived in the city itself. It's not the ground Nanjing, it's the city itself. And it is the capital of Jiangsu province, and it has been the capital of the past China. And also quite important geography feature is that it's along the south bank of the Yangtze River. The topographical of China is generally say it's the western high and the eastern is plain. So it's the river is from the plateaus to the eastern river, and Nanjing is just located in the lower trend of Yangtze River Delta. It's a well-developed area of China, one of the most actually developed area. And from this high-speed train network, we will also see Nanjing is located very key joint point to the west and also between north and south. And there's another one is night light map. We'll see from the sky, the Yangtze Delta, Yangtze River Delta is the most, just like you say, it's so the shining. It's the most busy and with nightlife. Actually, it's the most urbanized place. It's the key city and also the heart city of that. And generally, we can see. Too fast. Where is the laser? Yangtze River. And here is the mountains, purple golden mountain. And there are some small hills around there and also a lot of water here. So the city is just located in the river and mountain. And this is a city wall, and there are some inner river. We call it the Mother River of Nanjing. Sorry, I'm not so good. And when we talk about the regeneration, we will look back on this historical process. In China, actually, how to construct a city as it must have some, it must have its ideological background. Actually, we have two different approach. One, we call it the ideal city pattern. It's different from the Renaissance ideal city, but it's also quite geometric principles has. Actually, it reflects the Chinese philosophy. We call it the cosmic, and also it's concerned on the power of the empire. So we can say, it will talk about the principle is talking about orientation facing south, north, and also front and back, and also orthodox and also symmetry. It's quite geometric things, actually. And we call it the city should have the world firstly, then you will have your periphery. And each site usually should have 9 li, it's about 3 miles, and 3 gateways on each site. And also each gate will have 3 arteries, 3 roads. And also in the heart should be the palace. And then there are some ancestor temple on the left, and also markets somewhere in the front or back. It has very clear defined the city pattern. And this city pattern was described, actually was take forward. It's about, you can say it's about 500 BC. We don't know the exact years. And that is ideal city, but we really have some big cities, some capitals are constructed following this principle. This is the Xi'an city, and this is Beijing. This is Beijing was built firstly in 14th century, and this is expanding later on till 16th century around. And Chang'an, the Xi'an is the first big city are really following that principle. But we will see this kind of pattern is just suitable to the planned place. If we look at the, another kind of city pattern, we call it organic pattern. It's also it's also took forward around the same dynasty, the similar years. It's also another philosopher named Guanzi. He said, of course, the feng shui idea is behind. It's more concerned on the nature, and also another branch of the Chinese philosophy. The most important thing is the man and the nature's relationship. It's not just the man-made artificially geographic things. And the most important thing is to integrate the city into the natural environment. How to take use of the river, the here, the geographies, topography elements, and how to choose the location, and how to dealing with this bi-climate aspect things. So it might be in format, it might be irregular and organic. But of course, the orientation is also quite important to facing south and also the front and back. So the clear principle of that, the mountain should be under your back and the hills on two sides, and also the water in front all flows through the city could be the best location. There are also some models of this city. This is at Guangzhou. This painting is drawn in around 19th century. We can see the city with the city wall, but located with the mountain back and also the river just in front of it. And this is Hangzhou, another one, in around 14th century. But Nanjing is quite unique in China. The unique value of this city is it's not only one kind of ideal city. It's really, we really can call it's including these two advantages. We can see in historical process around the BC 229 is about more than 2,200 years ago. The city just located in this blank with all the hills, mountain around. And later on, 1,000 years ago, it's built following the ideal city. It's built a square, a rectangular city. And later on, in Ming Dynasty, it's 400 years later, when the empire built the capital, it really take very good advantage of this water and mountain and so on. We can see from the very beginning to the later on, the location of the city. Firstly, it's a military fortress, and later on it became a capital. This is the first capital, and another one. So the location of it's always changing. We can see this, but this one is the city wall nowadays still remained. It was built in Ming Dynasty. We can clearly see there are two axes of the city. This is along this river, this is another one, and because there are lake, mountain, and river, they are really limited the boundary of the city. The city actually in the history has been 10 times of capital of China. Not the whole China, sometimes it's a part of Rhine. But in these 10 times capitals, these two times are quite important to define city as itself now. This is the Ming Dynasty, and this is the Republic of China. We're talking about the Ming Dynasty city construction. I think the city shaping is really made by the topography and the power. We can see the first emperor of the Ming Dynasty, when he chose Nanjing as his capital, he asked the soldiers to build these four round city walls in around 10 years. The inner palace is here, and the forbidden city, inner palace is here, forbidden city, and this is the mountain, and this is the city wall we can see now. And this is another one, an outer defensive city. It's outer city. It's totally it's 6 kilometers long, and now it still remains 43. We still can see the ruin of it. And now it's become a green belt in planning of the city. This kind of city layout, the city wall has its feature and quite a great contribution to the to Nanjing. Firstly, the geographically boundary is quite clever to use the river, Yangtze River. The river is moving actually eastward. Yangtze River, firstly, it's really just along this city wall, and now it's moved to that way. And also the lake and this mountain. And also some the inner river. And also the artificially round city wall. And this ground layout, it shows the great empire and also the greatest war in the world, the longest war in the world. And it shows clearly the integrated of nature and artificial elements. And also these four layers are the territory hierarchies quite clear. Even the soldiers can stay here, can stay somewhere here, and also the mountain could be the nature defensive, the defense, and defensive also has its layers. And another a great idea is now we can call it sustainable, but 600 years people will not know that. The city, inner this city wall, there are the land are mixed used, the administrative, the living, people are living somewhere here mostly, and also they can farming somewhere here, and also somewhere here, even they can fishing here because there are a lot of ponds and water, lake, river, and also the defense, the soldiers can just stay here, can just stay here. And also the capital leave a lot abundant and also flexible area for the future. Even now, we can see later on the planning are not close to this outer wall. In 17th century, a person have joined 40 things of the city of Jinling. Jinling is the old name of Nanjing. What I want to show you here, because is this nice views are all integrate the city, the life with the nature. We call it man-made and the nature, the harmonies and also integration. There are different kind. One is someone are the nature and city view, someone are show the building on the hill feet or the building in the mountain or building on the slope, and also some civic life as humanity things. So just quickly show a little bit the atmosphere, and also you just saw this building, this view, pagoda in the video. It's in the northeast part of the city. It's part of the city wall. It's part of the city wall. And also, it's just to take use of this small hill as the defensive elements. If we see from the Yangtze River, we can see it's quite slope and quite well for the defense. And this is another one. This is just near the lake, and the building here. It's along the slope of the mountain, of the small hill, and also with a pagoda to be a landmark. When you see the city from the outside, you can easily find this pagoda. And also this big this is another because this is a highly pagoda actually at that time. It was built in the 14th century, 16th century, and later on destroyed in 19th century. But now it's rebuilt in a new form. I think maybe you remember in the video. This is just located in the south gate of the city. So it's another. It's built on the plain, not on the on the hill or on the mountain, but the highest pagoda also can be seen far away. And it's the entrance, it emphasizes entrance of the main city. And around this pagoda, there are really the city life, very lively. Even the map is not so precisely, we still can see this unique pattern of the city. And also this longest city wall remain till now. This pattern and also this city wall be kept to form the city till now. We can see easily to see there are two access of the city. And also the people are more lived here. And there are some administrative, even it's not functioned as a capital. It is still a city of this province, a capital city of this province. You can see the city image. When you ask someone who visited Nanjing, usually he will tell you the impressive of this water, of the mountain, and tree, and the city. That is quite unique features of our city. And these features are not only because of its nature advantage, it's also because of the man-made integrated into the city, into the nature. Another important period of Nanjing, shaping Nanjing, is this, we call it the transitional period. It's the Republic of China. We can call this time, this period, the city shaped was made by democracy and modernization. The quite important person is the founder of the Republic of China, named Sun Yat-sen. This is his mausoleum. When he died in Beijing, his remains, his body was carried from Beijing to Nanjing to here to his tomb. And for this quite serious events and big events, the city has a chance to grow in another way, to change the form of the city. This from the Yangtze River, from the railway station here, the government just built up this Zhongshan Road directly to the eastern part, to the eastern of the city, his tomb. And this is a chance to change a city. And along this road, there are quite a few administrative buildings were built. And this is a chance to the city to grow in another way. And another quite important event of this city is in 1927, the central government of the Republic of China invite an American architect named Henry Murphy to do a planning for the capital. This is the first city planning of Nanjing, and it is issued by central government in 1927, April. It is the first modern city planning in China, but when Murphy did this capital planning, this urban planning, he really read the city quite carefully and respects the history seriously. The periphery of the city, we can see, of the city is still along the main outer wall, this defensive wall, but now it's transformed into the greenery belt. And he briefly to including the both sides of Yangtze River. The Yangtze River is no longer as the boundary of city, but the inner waterway of the city. Even the another side, because the railway station is already here, and the summer ports are already here. So the brief planning, it's across this big river. And he remained this inner, this city wall as concourse. And also he kept the people, the original local people, residents, are still living in the south part of the city. That is the core of Nanjing. And also, since there are more population and there are more administrative staffs are moving to the city, so he built, he found some other place. This is for the central government section. The central government section is just close to the city, it's next to the city in the east part. And also he zoning and built up the infrastructure system as a modern city. This picture shows quite clearly this is the original traditional residential area for the local people. And here are the new modern house area for the new citizens. And also for quite a lot, because it's a capital, so there are embassies, there are also some foreigner staffs there. And this picture shows quite clear the road system was built up firstly for the city. And now it still works very well. Also, the functional zoning in the city, we can see some administrative, as I mentioned before, along this route, along this access, and also some commercial place around this the port, also the center of the city, and also along the Fuzimiao, the old center of the of the center of the old city, and also some industrial along the river, and also some outside place, And also in this period of time, the new building types emerged in this old city, such as National Assembly Hall, some gallery, some present, some embassy, many things, I will not talk too much. And also the modern public buildings, for example, the railway station, the National Art Gallery, the cultural, educational, medical institution, and blah, blah, blah. And also this is my university. You also have seen this is the plan of our university. The interesting thing is this university calls the national number four national or the central university of Republic of China, but it was designed by this building is designed by Murphy. And there are some other buildings that are designed by Chinese architects, but in the Western style, there are another university named Nanjing University was totally designed by the American architects, but in Chinese style. This period of time, it's shaped the city, has such kind of features and also contributions. Firstly, it made the city modernization. It's become a modern city. It's not an empire time city or capital. It brings a modern life. It makes the city lively. And also it formed urban structure with some new access, some new growth. And also the city has a functional zoning. And in the same time, it's expansion outward and also it developed inward, like along the axis to the west north, And also, it's established the modern city with infrastructure system and also industrial. And also, it brings some new buildings, new types, and also this kind of commercial place. The third period is after 1949, till the open and reform in China was set in 1978. This time we call it early socialist period. It's somehow it's quite calm, but with some dramatic political events. It's not open to the world. It's somehow itself grows quite slowly. So I think this time the city, the shape of the city has not been changed a lot, but it has its own features. I think this time we can call it politics and power making the city. The most important things at this period of time is people will not have their personal properties. Everything becomes national. The national ownership, everything, even the people yourself. And also the city, it's not only for people living, it's also for production. So we can see a lot of chimney. That is a flourish of the city, the sign of a flourish of the city. And in this period of time, a special thing, a new, we call it society, and also the urban morphology unit comes. It names Danwei. Danwei. What is Danwei? Danwei means awarded, also closed space. It's independent, but mixed used periphery. Good for your whole life and also for your whole family. It's a place you can work in, you can live in, you can study, you can grow in, and even you can die. Everything could be a Danwei, like a university, like a factory, like administration. Take myself as an example. My father also worked in the same university as I work in now. So we are all the member of this Danwei. When I was 3 years old, I just went to the kindergarten of this university. And when I have some year, I just go to the hospital of this university. And when I was for some universities, they also have, or some factories, they also have their own primary school, middle school, and the university. So you can really spend the whole life in a same place. That is Danwei. That is Danwei. This is the Nanjing municipal government office are in the west part, and the people just living in the eastern part. The eastern part, the apartments, you cannot buy it. You can occupy, you can use it, but you need to pay. But of course, it's very low pace. It's a low rented apartment. Such kind of things happened in each city in China. This is some manufacturers in city. There are different kind of factory. I cannot read it. Some are built up the trucks. Some are built up some special machines. But every part, every plot, you can work in, and also you can live in there. But the quite important feature of this kind of Danwei is it is always with closed round wall. So the city are not opened as before. The city are occupied by many closed inner worded Danwei. And this is the university. At this time, the university in Nanjing has a host quite a few good universities. So each university just occupies some special place, a special place. And another kind of morphological unit of the city emerged is there is workers' living quarters. Because as I mentioned before, the city is not only for living, it's also for production. So quite a lot of citizens are workers. The workers' living quarter also will appear everywhere of the city. They are just has such kind of parallel layers, the high efficient layouts, and such kind of planning can be found in throughout the whole China, from north to south, and also from east to west. So this period just leave this closed Danwei and also this quite like a uniform housing in the city. But from 1978, we call this open and reform of China. The China just enter its rapid urbanization period. And this time, for the first 30 years, we can call it the city was made by the capital and also the market. The city, from the infrastructure, the road system, and also we can see from this expansion, this urban sprawl, are quite fast during the last 30 years. As Nanjing itself, sometimes the city are really grows very fast, also because of some big events. In 2001, the western part of the city, we call it the Hexi New Town, started to construction because the 10th National Sports Meeting. Has been held here, so the city started to sprawl quickly to the west and also to some other place, to some other directions. We can so this is the city city world itself, but now it's all sprawled to anywhere. This is the model of 10 years of this place, but now it's totally built even more. The city becomes higher and also more dense. The city plan in 2001 shows the city need to grow for the four direction actually everywhere. And the inner city is there special mentions. The inner city should be improved and also the old city should be renewal. Just 5 years later, we can see the new city plan is much beyond the planning 5 years ago. It's even cross the big river to another side. So the city, you cannot read the original shape of the city. It's almost cannot be seen because the city outside is higher and expand quite far away. And from 1990s, the important thing is the housing market started. So the personal property are protected by the law again. The capital comes. The hot money comes a lot. That caused the rapid urban growth. I will not mention too much because I think you know, you all know China, what China happened in the last 20 years. We just compare some maps we can show. We can see this is the road system in 1946. Almost 10 years later, after the capital planning, it just built some more roads. And 40 years later, we still working inside the city wall to make more dense or more high speed road. But another 25 years only, 26 years later, we can see the network of the roads is already looks like it's such big and such no limit actually. It's spanned everywhere, occupies so many farmland. And compared to the living quarter in 80 years ago, it's just concentrate. It's just a assembly here. And 20 years later, it's brought along this axis to there because they built some more housing here. And in 2010, the yellow one is the new built housing. It's already spread a little bit outside, but just 5 years later, you can see even this place in 30 years ago, it's still quite of a wet line actually, the high water level. It's not so good for construction, the high rise, but now it's full of the high rise housing. It's full of the high rise housing. Just a few years, the city totally changed its appearance. And also the city wall was renewed in different period of time. Now it's become a walkway and also greenery of the city. And this is under the planning. And now this is the city wall and also the outer defensive wall are already planned as a green belt. This period of time just happened. Are the first urbanization period, but it really caused a lot of problem and also some questions give us. The government together with developer and also investors abroad and home, seeking for the best profit without considering the city features, historical, cultural values, and people lives, especially the local people. Too fast urbanization process causes the high quantity but the low quality. It causes the city unlivable, unfriendly, and also the life becomes inconvenient. The capital-driven housing market makes the people, especially the mid and low-income residents, unaffordable to live, to pay. And the old city often to become a slum or to be demolished instead of to be renewed. So such kind of things happened. When people, maybe one year you still can see such kind of a traditional thing, but 1 year later or even 1 month later, it's just become the bricks. And later on, such kind of building will be built in very fast speed. When we look at of this full period of the city shaping, we can see, we just take two special place or two special things. One is the city center of the commercial center or the CBD. in traditional way, it's like this, and in transition period, it's like this, and now it's like this. It's like all over the world, the big city center. And the living quarter from the traditional way, the density, the lower stories becomes the rows, the long rows, six maybe stories, multi stories, and later on become the higher stories and become high rise, the people lived here, the density of people living are getting higher, but the building itself, it's the dense actually it occupies the land, it's reduced, reduce one side, it's create more open space, but another side, the close relationship between the neighborhoods are lost now. Make a conclusion of this for period. First period as a long history, more than 1,000 years, we can see the city shaped by the topography and power. And from 1911, in the Republic of China, in this modernization period, the city was shaped by democracy and modernization. And in the earlier socialist, the city was made by politics and also the power, the central power. Under the last 30 years, when we were in the rapid urbanization period, the whole city was shaped by the capital and the market. All these ways, all these different ways, different making ways are all the top down. Actually, there are even the different things that are driven behind, but they are all the one direction. The government, the developers, the investors, empire. How about the people? The people who are living here, where are they? And also some other stakeholders. And also, where are they? They are absent, actually. So, facing to such kind of the realities, some problems, we are doing some experiment renewal project. We try to find some way to improve, to make the city in its right way. We call it's a common profit way. I just take the case of this Da You Fang Xiang block project as a case to explain a little bit. This project we have already did 2 years. This is what it looks like now. We can easily to see it is located in surrounded by this multi stories. But it's still kept its own, but it's quite mixed. It's not so pure. This is the planning, what we did. And some images. We called the keywords of the project is, first is the people's living. We want to keep the people who live here. And also, we would like to have to keep the historical culture value. And also, we would like to vitalize this village in the city, we can call. As a background of this place, it's the river, the city moat, and the city walls here. This is just a the main entrance, the city gate, the most former city gate here, and the Da You Fang Xiang is just located here. It's on the list of, it's one of the 22 historical preserved plots of Nanjing. And it has its higher historical and also cultural value. The idea or the objective of this project we take is we try to combine this urban renewal to improve the environment quality and also the living quality, plus the historical preservation. And also we would like to push it into a small scale and progressive renewal to vitalize this block in a span of time. It's not just date, just finished. And there are some Chinese. There are just some historical and existing situation starting. This is the street and the lane we can started it from quite earlier map till now. We still can see the whole structure of this plot are remained very well. The special structure of the street, there are some important lanes also with its name and also its stories. And we started fabric, but also with the ownership of this land use and also this courtyard unit, how to organize this courtyard units. With this ownership map, also this courtyard organization, the fabric, we can find the special features of this place and also how to transform from during these 80 years. And with the professional person's help, we can find there are some buildings should be preserved, some relics, also some historic buildings we can take use. There are different extent, different degree to be used or to be protected. And also some are trees, some are wells, some walls even. And the quite different things we did this time is we starting this ownership. According to this map of 2060 of each properties of each house, the their ownership, we clarified the 215 ownership unit. It's the minimal, it's the smallest unit we can count. It could be a courtyard, or also it could be a one single building. It could be one single building. But we were, if you can see these legends, each unit could be the different owner. Some are the state. Some are the Danwei, they still have some Danwei. Some are shared with some other neighborhood, some are personal, and some are just rent. So there are quite different complex ownership here. Here, last month, we already got about 40 courtyards residents designed to move out because this area will be renewed, will be to do something. The whole project actually was operated by the governor owned or the state owned company. It's not the profit, it's not the only one object objective of this project. So that's the chance for us to find a way to do this urban renewal. So they gave the quite high awards to these people who like to move out, and use the money they get, they can buy some other apartments lived in around or outside the city. That's why we already got these 40 courtyard people who would like to move out. Actually, we don't want to people all moved out. We would like some people still can live here. And the existing transportation, this street and lane will be kept. Also, some public open space, not so big, but we still can find the potential for the later planning. And also there are some public service facilities. Some are served for this block, some are served for surrounding. And also we did quite carefully investigation of the blocks. There are part of some of them, I will show you the quality. This is the quality. Some are a structure in wooden, in timber, or in brick, or in concrete, or something else, or temporary. And also the square meter of each properties. We have a principle that if one home, one family lived under 28 square meters, he will have the first priority to be improved, to be designed again, to be enlarged somehow. And the existing buildings ownership was really carefully examined. There are different kind I have already mentioned. And what we did is we have this property, the number, give this property, and the number is quite complicated. It's about it's in which part 1, 2, 3, 4, and it can be accessed by the main lane, or it should be through a courtyard. And in this building, there could be the first one, or second one, or third one. So each number we gave this property, we can easily find where it is and what kind of situation it has. And then we have a quite big tables to show all the existing situation, and we can give some assessment. And each also the ownership unit, this single building or this courtyard, we have the quite carefully, quite detailed information. It can be sure how to enter it and how big and how many families lived in one building, how many people are shared one ownership. And upon such kind of quite amount unfair work, we start to design. And the principle and the strategy of this planning is as below. First is urban renewal plus historical preservation I mentioned before, and also its priority to infrastructure and public space, public service facility, and also the small scale and progressive renewal process are recommended. And also we are emphasize this top-down planning design plus the bottom-up self-generation generated, and also the ownership unit as can be as a working unit, but it will be in different layers and types I will explain later. All these things cannot be carried out without the public participate. This is final, not final actually. In this phases, we just submit to the government the master plan. And also for each parcels, the index to control the intents of the land use. This is the transportation system. We improved it. We let the vehicles inside, but special and also the firefighting vehicle can be accessed to each courtyard. And also we provide summer parking place. And improve this firefighting system. Also, this greenery and public space. We designed some small yards, some garden. I will not explain more. It's not the. And also, this public surface service facilities. Some public toilet because of its location, it will be part of the tourist destination around the old city and the old southern city. So this public service facility will not only served for the residents who lived here, will also serve for the tourists. And about the how to work, how to really carry out this renewal according to the ownership study, we define the three layers. This courtyard hierarchies we call three layers of ownership. The first one, the highest one, is the parcels, which I showed with the index we were gave. Each parcel will be the basic unit controlled by the planning index. The second layer is in between. It is united basic ownership unit. What means the united? It's all the joint. It could be the basic joint unit for design and for the reuse, but it's dynamic because you may have your neighborhood on the left. He want to work with you, cooperate with you, or another one want to cooperate with you. So you two or you three or your group can be used as a whole, can be designed as a whole to be reused. So this could be a dynamic things. And another is the essential unit is we call the 215 unit. They are the basic unit, but this one is not for design immediately. And sometimes it could be useful to collect these properties, this land, for the later on could be have a bigger, because each one is quite small. Later on the neighborhood can work together with you, so it can become the layer two, then we can really work and we can really design on this one. Of course, the best things happened if all this parcel, all the residents lived in the parcel have the same idea. They all moved out, or they all agree to be renovated, but it's not happened. It usually will not be happened. So the middle layer is quite important to be operate. The layer one, we have 18 unit. We have 18 parcel actually. So we give this each parcel the land use, the type of land use. Most of them are still the living, but some of them, because of the original building itself, we will define them into some public, maybe some small commercial, or some are public service, or some administrative. And there, these are the this one and this one and this one are the existing things we cannot move actually. And also here, here is a primary school, we cannot move. So each parcel will give the ratio, including the intent of the land yield and also the height, the limited of the height. And for each unit, we give the suggestion of this building itself according to its quality, according to its value, also according to its situation and the location. It could be preserved, could be restored, could be demolished, could be adaptive, reused, or reused in any way. According to this kind of different layers and different types, we try to realize these two different ways, the top-down renewal and also bottom-up renewal. So top-down will be including to remove all the buildings on the way or location for public uses. For example, the roads, the streets, or some are necessary, for example, here, because this road is too narrow that people, the fire car cannot access, cannot going through. So we ask them, we just label this building should be removed, or some inner, some small buildings. And another thing is we preserve the cultural relics and also the historical buildings. This is what we do actually, the top down. But we also encourage the bottom up things. The bottom up things, except these kind of things, we encourage the people who lived here, who rent or owned here, they can, according to their householders' own willing, and adopt a different way amongst government organization or neighborhood cooperation or self-operating, the different way to improve or to renovate or to reuse. I just show you a little bit about the focus of this public place. This is the original, it's a temple here. A temple here, so we would like to recall people the memory of this site, the memory of the events, the memory of this this temple and also the activity. So we rebuilt a little bit. I will not show more. And here, since China now is all over the world, it's aging society, especially in such kind of place, in such kind of blocks, the elderly people are lived here because they lived here for many years, more than we met an old lady who has already lived here over 70 years. So she won't, she doesn't want to move out. So we suggest to build some elderly housing here as a public service. And also because there are some famous persons, their house are still be kept well here. Combine that, we rebuilt a small garden, a Chinese garden, and also transform his old house into his museum. And so on. I will not mention more. Yes, and some even some are the modern apartment, not only the traditional one or two stories building. We still want to keep them because they are all part of this site. They are part of this site. They show the historical trace of the site transformation. So we all suggest this building to be kept. Finally, we try to put forward to, we call it 335 action agenda. What means is 335? That means the first three is three approaches to realize such kind of urban renewal. One is the design and building and construction. Another is the community construction. That means the people who are lived there, they can work together, they can work something for themselves. And also the capitals and policy need supported, all the things happened. And another three means we can have the three operational modes, which I mentioned before, the bottom-up mode, people can really choose. One is the government organization. The government will be the key road to realize the whole things. Or another way is the neighborhood, you can cooperate yourself. And also, if it's a single person or single family, you can also do some self-operation to your own home, to your own house. And but all these things could be happened only on this, we call it the multi-parties platform, maybe five, maybe more. These multi-parties, including the administrative government, and also the developer or the investor, and also the neighborhood office. The neighborhood office can organize the people, the residents themselves. And also the residents or the NGO organizations, they can self-management. In Nanjing, we really have some communities has very well organized self-management group. They can make community they can organize a different kind of clubs, events, and also to improve their own living environment. And the fifth part is a professional designer and builder. And this is five parties platform. I'm sorry, it's in Chinese. It's too many words, so I didn't translate. But I think it's still can easily be understood. It just means what the things should be carried by the administrative, the governor, and what kind of things could be organized by the local office, and what kind of things could be done by the neighborhood self-organization, and what kind of things could be the community planner or architects doing, and also some expert system can be done, give some advice, and also what the things could be this developer and also the construction company doing. All these different parties worked together and maybe in different phases. And we are trying to build up such kind of a new pattern of urban renewal. That means we hope this top-down and bottom-up, these two ways can be interactive, and also the multi-stakeholders can participate into the whole process, which we call it the common profit-making the city. Thank you very much.